This Halloween, I think it's time for a real treat. We're going back to one of the best horror games of all time, Doom. I remember when this came out, it was so badass. You couldn't just say Doom. You had to say Doom or fucking Doom. A proper example in a sentence would be, hey, when I get home from school, I'm gonna play some fucking Doom. It was more than a game. It was a rite of passage. If you play this, you're cool. Enough with all that other shit. This is the real deal. Everybody was talking about it. Everybody was playing it.
You're an officer on board this ship, and I require you to perform your duty. That is an order, Commander.
Look, come on. Let me use it. 5 minutes. I'll pay you back.
There was even a rumor that somebody got Doom running on a McDonald's kiosk, but that wasn't true. But somebody actually did get Doom running on a McDonald's cash register. Doom was the reason computers were invented. It was one of the first times I ever heard about system requirements. Megabytes? What the hell is that shit? Will it work on my Commodore 64? Let's find out. Well, I guess I'm not cool. No Doom for me. Hey, that's fine. I'll wait. So while that loads, I'm going to talk about my memories of Doom. Before Doom, first-person shooters, FPS, wasn't what it is today. Back then, FPS stood for fucking piece of shit. Just look at Fester's Quest. You can see what I mean. At the time, I thought it was great. Never could I have imagined that three-dimensional games would become so much smoother and more detailed. But then id Software dropped on us Wolfenstein 3D. Holy shit! And then, in 93, came the big motherfucker, Doom. It melted our faces, blew our minds, stained our pants, both sides of the pants. Even the instruction manual had one of the best plots I have ever read. You're a tough, mean-ass space marine who gets sent to Mars for assaulting a superior officer. There's a line that says, "Matching heads with torsos to send home to the folks became a full-time job." All the trouble starts when something evil comes out of an interdimensional gateway. Your radio picks up the sounds of combat, guns firing, men yelling orders, screams, bones cracking. Then finally, silence. The way it's written chills your bones and gets you ready to play. When this came out, it was a genuinely scary game. You never knew when a demon was lurking around the corner. Sometimes you'd hear a snarl. You'd jump and say, "Whoa, where is he? Where is he?" It makes you paranoid as fuck. You had to watch your back. And then when you least expect, those evil bastards would get up in your face. This is a game where the sound plays a big part. You had to listen so you know what's coming. And when you shoot those demons, those growls and screams are so brutal. You never get bored of hearing it. It's so satisfying to gun them down. The way their bodies fall into bloody piles is priceless. Some of them, their guts spill out, and it's amazing. I couldn't believe such a gory video game could exist. It's one big, beautiful fucking bloodbath. It was shocking, it was sick, and messed up. It wasn't just a game you play for fun. This is a game you play to blow off some fucking steam. Have I been saying fucking a bit much? Well, that's because I'm talking fucking Doom. Man, I just want to play it now. Let me ask, in video games, what happens to enemies after they're defeated? they disappear, right? That's usually what happened, but not in Doom. The corpses stay on the ground. You could even leave the room, come back, and they're still there. I didn't even know programming that was even possible. It's handy, too. Whenever I get lost, I just look for the trail of dead bodies to see where I've been. It's easy to get lost as the mazes get more complex as you go on. Sometimes you almost have to play with the map screen on, which is kind of funny because now you're just an arrow. Kind of feels like you're controlling the spaceship and asteroids. By the way, you could even hump the walls. Oh, and those weapons. Man, those weapons. It feels triumphant when you pick up a chain gun, or a plasma gun, or a chainsaw. There's nothing more vicious and foul than when you're grinding away at a demon's face. Oh, damn! And just think, since Texas Chainsaw Massacre, the idea of chainsaws being depicted as weapons was a pretty savage concept. I had never seen it done in a game in such an epic, bloody way. And then there's the BF fucking G. Yes, the big fucking gun. Don't give me that Bioforce gun bullshit. It's the big fucking gun. And if you run out of ammo, your last resort is your fists. Man, who goes around punching demons in the face? That's gotta take some serious shit, man. Oh, and wait till you get berserk. Now you can punch so hard, some of the demons explode. You don't wanna fuck with this guy. Yeah! The music, dude, it doesn't mess around. It just rocks your balls off with the soundtrack by Metallica, Slayer, Pantera, Alice in Chains, AC/DC, and more. Oh wait, those bands didn't actually sign off? You can call them soundalikes, or inspired by, but damn, some are identical. Just listen to the comparisons on YouTube. Either way, I'm not complaining, because metal and doom go together better than coffee and cream. I've already said this game can be scary, but when you get to the later levels, it gets flat out traumatizing. As a kid, playing this all alone in your room late at night freaks you out. The walls are covered in flesh and blood, there's faces popping out everywhere. This place is bad news. It's as if you're descending deeper and deeper into hell. Look at that. They said it best in John Carpenter's The Thing. You gotta be fucking kidding me. There's a guy crucified with statues barfing blood. There's a beating heart. I just need to ask, how did this place get this way? So, great game. But here's where we talk about all the bad parts. So, what are some of the things that are wrong with this game? Nothing. Absolutely nothing. It's the fucking best. That's all there is to it. And if one awesome game wasn't enough, well then came Doom 2. Man. Doom 2's got everything. Even has a famous Easter egg. While facing the final boss, the Icon of Sin, you go through the wall and find a head on a spike, which is designer programmer John Romero. The legacy of Doom can barely be charted, as it's influenced too many games to count. It's been the subject of several mods, like Mario Doom, Batman Doom, Seinfeld Doom, and there's a ton more weird mods out there. And still, Doom holds up. Whereas many other 3D games from this era become dated. Remember Zero Tolerance on Genesis? No? Well, good. But Doom, we can't forget. When we inhabit Mars, we'll still be playing Doom. Oh, I gotta play it. I gotta play it! Oh. Come on. That WAD file's gotta load! Load that WAD! Don't jerk me around! Fucking Doom! I gotta play Doom! 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 I must play Doom!
Doom!
I gotta play Doom! 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 Oh, Doom! I sell my soul to play some Doom! Speaking backwards. I know. It's that devil shit. Can you repeat that, please?
You wish to play Doom? I can make that happen.
You can help me to play Doom?
How much are you willing to suffer for it?
What do you mean? What's the deal? And do you have to keep speaking backwards?
Actually, that would be a lot easier, so that I don't have to think of all my sentences in reverse.
Okay, good.
Anyway, you want to play Doom, right?
Yeah, I want to play Doom. What do I have to do?
You shall live your life playing crappy games.
Fine. I already do that. And they're not crappy games, they're shitty games. Come on, you're the devil.
Do you accept these terms?
Yeah, whatever. Give me Doom!
You shall have your Doom.
You son of a bitch. That's pretty good. Fuck. Well, this is Doom on Super Nintendo. What can you say? Just look at it. Doom Guy needs to see an eye doctor. It's so pixelated, it's practically a mosaic. The graphics are real dark, too, but not in a creepy, atmospheric kind of way, like a murky, ugly kind of way. Enemies can't turn around. They're like cardboard cutouts, they have no back. But on the other hand, the music is great. The control is also very smooth. Strafing with L and R works real well. The only drawback is that you can't turn around as fast as you could with a mouse. You have to give it credit because it's a 16-bit console. They made Doom work well under the circumstances. It even has an online multiplayer feature using the X-band modem. That was definitely ahead of its time.
This is a good port, but it's nowhere near as good as the PC version.
Okay, you got me. Can I play the real Doom now?
Oh, you're not satisfied? Try this.
Doom on Sega 32X. Now, this has got to be better. It's 32-bit. That's twice the bits as Super Nintendo. Oh god. Well, the resolution is an improvement, but not as good as the PC. It still looks pretty murky and pixelated. But the music? What's going on? Did we go backwards in technology?
Sounds like somebody shoved a harmonica up their ass and farted through it.
This is a downgrade from the Super Nintendo version. You can compare them side by side and see the level designs are actually missing certain things, like this hole. Where'd the hole go? Turning around is still a chore, and three buttons on the Genesis just doesn't cut it. You gotta get the six-button controller. Not to mention, it has 15 levels compared to the 22 levels on the Super Nintendo version.
Alright, enough joking around. I want the real Doom.
Trust me. I have a version that'll be more to your liking.
PlayStation?
Whoa, that's actually pretty cool.
It has its own original title music, which sounds like the Danny Elfman Batman theme. I think that's cool, but hang on. Did they change all the music? All the Pantera and Slayer stuff is gone. Replaced by some droning atmospheric music. Which is still cool, I guess. It's creepier. Oh well,
The graphics are superb, almost like the PC. They even added some color tinting to some of the rooms to help you distinguish where you're at. The controls are smooth. Everything operates fine. It even includes Doom 2, which is a big bonus. None of the other ports had Doom 2. So there's not much to complain about here. It's a near-perfect port of Doom. But man, that music, it just doesn't feel complete without those rockin' tunes.
So I have to pass on this one too. Come on, can you at least give me one version of Doom that checks all the boxes?
Try this one for size.
Okay, well, Doom on the Sega Saturn. I wish I could say it's better than the 32X. The graphics are a bit more crisp, but it's darker, and the controls are a little more laggy. It also has random slowdown every now and then. It could be a case where playing it on a CD is not as stable as on a cartridge. I don't know. Also, where's the music? It's the same atmospheric drone like the PlayStation. No Metallica, nothing. Did they get a cease and desist from Lars fucking Ulrich?
That music ain't cutting it. You gotta give me a better Doom.
Oh, you don't like that music? Well, see how you like this.
Jaguar?
Oh, this has to be a joke. Listen to that. Hear that music? No, you don't. There is no music.
Okay, so you might remember that I've already brought this up in my Jaguar episode back in 2009.
Doom. This is one of the best console ports of Doom that I've played. It comes as close to the PC version as it gets. But they had to ruin it with one thing. There's no music during the gameplay. Really? Was there any reason not to have music?
But shortly after that episode, I got a message from designer Sandy Peterson explaining the situation. I'll just summarize by saying it was a money issue. From what I was told, the contract with the composer meant having to pay him the same amount for the Jaguar version as the PC version, and clearly the Jaguar would sell far less copies. He ended by saying, "I know that's a shitty reason to leave out the music, but there you have it." Pretty awesome of him to respond, right? Otherwise, it's not a bad version of Doom. The controls are alright. It's the only version to have a custom keypad overlay. Sure, holding C to strafe is a bit clunky, and the map screen's a little weird. It's almost like playing an Atari game. Actually, I am playing an Atari game.
Okay, that's it. Can you do any better? Or should I say, can you do any worse?
Eat this.
3DO?
Oh my god! Oh my god! The music! It's amazing! It's even better than the PC version! It's like they re-recorded the music with like a real guitar! Even includes some pinch harmonics! Wow. So there it is. The best Doom music. But as for the game, it's the fucking worst!
The resolution and frame rate is terrible. The controls more laggy and more delayed than any of the other versions. You can shrink the screen to make it run a little smoother, but who wants that? The story goes that designer programmer Rebecca Heineman had only 10 weeks to rush the port through development. And I've heard she's real cool and has shared stories about its production. She even shared some behind the scenes photos of what? FMV scenes? This game was going to have FMV scenes? They actually filmed a bunch of crazy stuff with full Hollywood-level monster costumes. It looks awesome. But sadly, it didn't make it in because it was delivered 2 weeks before release, and there wasn't enough time to make the deadline. But one thing that did make it in, when you die, your head explodes.
Wow! Let's see that again!
It's the only version of Doom where your head explodes. Amazing. If only the rest of the game were any good. Okay, so let's rank the Doom ports. Graphics. I'd say the best is PlayStation, and the worst is Super Nintendo. music. I'd say the best is 3DO, and the worst is Jaguar, because there is none. Control. The best is PlayStation, and the worst is 3DO. If I were to give them names, I'd call them Poor Man's Doom, Silent Doom, Mosaic Doom, Almost Doom, Cow's Anus Doom, and Diluted Diarrhea Doom. They all have their pros and cons. This is like a pick-your-poison situation. And no, I didn't forget about Doom 64, because that's a completely different game. I call this one Blind Doom, because it's so dark you can't see shit. If only it was the 64th version of Doom.
Wait, what about Doom on Game Boy Advance?
Really?
Doom on a handheld console? Do we really have to scrub the bottom of the shitbowl?
Actually, this is half decent. For a handheld console, the resolution's similar to Super Nintendo, but it's brighter and easier to see what you're doing. It controls fine. Music and sound are good. Not as good as PC, obviously, but for a portable version of Doom on Game Boy Advance, it's not bad.
Okay, there can't be any more of these. I'm done now, right?
Just hang in there. There's a few more.
Doom on the ZX Spectrum? Why would they port Doom on the ZX Spectrum? Why even bother? The graphics are what you'd expect, and the controls are so bad it's almost non-functional. Now you're really pulling my leg. Doom on NES? There's no way. Look at it. It's total garbage.
At least it works with the NES Zapper. That's good, I guess.
Doom on Game Boy? No. No. This is below the bottom of the toilet. We're all the way into the sewage plant at this point. Doom on Virtual Boy?
You know, I thought this would be a cool idea, to experience Doom in virtual reality, but this is way too soon. Not ready yet. Oh, man, at least the blood is red, because everything's red.
Doom on Atari 2600?
Yes, somebody actually made this.
Doom on Vectrex? Somebody actually got this to run?
Oh, that's it. I can't take any more. No more Doom.
No. It can't be. Doom on Tiger Electronic Handheld. This is fucked beyond belief. This is below human standards. This game is filth. This game puts the die in diarrhea! Who wants to play Doom on a Tiger handheld console? It can't get any worse. Oh God! It's worse! Doom on R-Zone! Doom on a wristwatch! Doom on a flip phone? Doom on a calculator? That's right, Doom on a calculator! The crazy thing is, you think I'm making this up. It's actually real. I am playing Doom on a calculator. Doom on a Wawa order screen? You can play Doom while you're ordering mac and cheese. Doom on a gas pump? Fill up your car while blasting away demons.
Don't smoke while you play it.
Doom on the Dreamcast memory card screen? The VMU?
I need to emphasize, not Doom on the actual Dreamcast, but on the memory card.
Doom on the screen of your car? Well, that's dangerous. Doom on your thermostat? Doom on your VCR clock?
Dig out your VCR for that one.
Doom on your microwave?
Good way to kill time while you're waiting for your food.
Doom on the turkey thermometer? Doom on a pregnancy test?
I'm not kidding here. For real, somebody got this to work.
Doom on the Odyssey? It's just a dot on the screen.
But that overlay works nice.
But it is the only Doom port where you get to use a realistic gun.
Doom the Water Arcade! Now we're past the limits of electronics. Doom the Etch-a-Sketch? Doom the Flipbook? Doom on a Rubik's Cube? Doom on Pogs? Fucking Pogs! And finally, Doom the Suppository! It's the only one with Doom 2, because it's number 2! Diarrhea dumped the Doom out! And by the way, I took 10 of them earlier!
In 1985, the Nintendo was released, and with it, a whole slew of launch titles. Now, there are 17 in this collection, and today, we're going to review every single one of them. So, yeah, strap yourselves in, this may take a while.
In October of 1985, Nintendo graced our country with the NES console.
Since the system here had been a huge hit in Japan for a few years already, well, they set their sights on the American market, but there's only one problem. We are still reeling from the video game crash of 1983. And unfortunately, retail companies were still avoiding anything to do with video games like the plague. So with that in mind, Nintendo did the genius idea of packaging the NES not as a video game console, but as a toy of the future. And they did this by creating a bundle that came with a controllable robot, a light gun zapper accessory, and two video games that would show off the complete mileage of the system. And for the price of $139.99, you could purchase this NES bundle for your very own. And in this first game, Gyromite, well, it would help show off the capabilities of Rob the Robot as you played as Professor Hector, sleepwalking through the level while your companion robot buddy here helps remove any pipe blocking your path. In the other game of Duck Hunt, well, this would highlight the light gun as you blasted any ducks flying into your line of fire. And fire! 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 Oh, that damn dog! Remember what happened last time, buddy? Oh, I've been waiting a long time for this.
Excellent.
Ah, memories. Now, once this NES bundle was released, it successfully broke through the stink of what the video game crash left behind and breathed new life back into this genre. And with it came a full library of 17 other games that you could purchase at the console's launch, all ranging from $20 to $30 each. With such a wide variety of video games, Nintendo had you covered with whatever game tended to feast your fancy. And since the assortment of these games were all over the place, the most iconic of these had to be Super Mario Bros. Throw this game up to any other video game released for the Atari at the time, and there was no contest. Super Mario Bros. Went above and beyond the normal expectations of everything on the market that was released by 1985. Because at the time, these graphics were simply state-of-the-art. The game didn't just limit you to one static screen like Pac-Man and other arcade classics did, but instead, you're given full stages and levels to advance through in order to beat it. And this single-handedly brought game's replayability to a whole other level, jumping on enemies to kill them, finding bonus items within random bricks, random pipes you could drop down into and explore, and hell, the first time I found that warp zone area, let's just say I had to grab a fresh pair of underwear because I literally flipped my shit right then and there. And it was these kind of Easter eggs that just didn't exist in video games at this point. And after this game was released, it spawned a whole revolution in the way games were made in the following decade. Super Mario Bros. Became so popular, Nintendo even included it in a brand new bundle the following year for the holiday season. Now, unfortunately, out of all these launch titles here, there's only one game besides Gyromite that would work with Rob the Robot, and that was a game called Stack Up. And if you're looking for a really fun game to play with this one, well, it just didn't happen because this game wasn't as fun as Gyromite because it involved a lot of repetition and some of the games, well, you just had to wait for the robot to respond to. And sometimes this could take a while. But thankfully for the light gun, well, the options were a little bit more plentiful. And first up with the game of Hogan's Alley, we are given three game modes to choose from. The first one here is a simple target practice game where you have targets scrolling in and you have to use your light gun to blast away any gang members. Ha! Huh! Blast his ass! That's what I'm talking about. Shoot any good guy though, and it'll count against you. Ah, damn it! What the hell? Ah, fuck you! Now when you start this game, they'll give you a few seconds to think about who to target and blast away. But by stage 30, well, you better know what the hell you're doing because the response time is quicker than diarrhea can slide into a milkshake. Oh, come on, I didn't even have time to... Oh, what? Oh, you fucking suck, you piece of... Oh, man. I don't know how that feels. Now in the second game here, well, we upgrade our target practice to having these spinner cutouts strumming in on the city scene here. And of course things get really damn tricky and suspenseful as you try not firing on normal citizens. Ah, damn, you almost got me. I guess all that's left to do now is to shoot these cans here and keep them from reaching the bottom. Oh, for God's sake, what else you got? Alright, let's try the second title here, which is Wild Gunman. And this is a game that puts you right smack in the middle of a shooting duel against any bad guy that comes moseying onto the screen. Draw! Take that, you filthy varmint! Now back in the day, I gotta say these light gun games were the absolute funk, just overflowing with fun, because it was just a great new concept for us kids to have fun with. And of course with this game, I just gotta say it, the music and sound effects were always two things I always enjoyed about this one. And especially with all the different character sprites coming to challenge you, oh man, just look at these crazy cast of banditos. Now the question remains, just which one of these ragtag band of gringos considered that wild gunman? I'm not sure, but with all this blasting going on, it's just pretty refreshing that there's no random citizens to pop up in this game and screw up your track record.
Oh, is this the Wild West? How'd I get here? What's going on?
Ronnie?
Oh, I wonder if I can find one of those stores that sells those big giant foam cowboy hats.
Ronnie, get the hell out of my game.
Oh man, I need to find that store.
Now as for these other launch titles, well if you wanted sports games, boy did Nintendo have you covered. Because if you want football, well here, try 10 yard fight on for size. Ported from the arcade game of the same name, this primitive pigskin fight was the best game around that could give you your NFL fix. And man, I remember playing the crap out of this game back then. Now we're a lot of years before Madden ever laid his greasy Cheeto covered mitts on this football game franchise. So of course we're stuck in the good old days of just passing and running video game sprites. And once trying to tackle someone, what the hell kind of a wonky sound is that? Somehow I don't remember this sound being too annoying back in the day, but in hindsight, I've been playing this game for 5 minutes and I've already got tinnitus. Alright, well anyway, you can't have football without some baseball, so now we're serving up some baseball. And nope, no fancy wordplay here, it's just baseball. Can't get more generic than that. Especially when the game only gives you 6 teams to choose from. Well, talk about a bare bones game. But interestingly enough, this game was actually developed by the legendary Shigeru Miyamoto. And it's funny because he actually stated one time that the only reason he made this game was because he felt that the NES needed baseball. Now, even though this game is simplistic in design, it can still be very challenging to beat. What? I struck out? Aw, son of a bitch! Alright, so let's switch gears up here to soccer! Wow, now we've got 7 teams to choose from? Well, up yours, baseball! And at the time, well, this game was touted as the best version of soccer around, and that's even despite the fact that every time I score a goal, it looks like the players are about to, take off on me. Now, I've never been a big fan of this sport. However, I do enjoy this halftime show. Alright! Yep, keep it going, girls! Doing fine! Alright, well, time to slow things down a bit with some golf here. Now, golf was impressively jam-packed with 18 different holes to play through. And at the time, well, no one, including Nintendo, thought it would be possible to pull off a feat like this. But it was legendary Satoru Iwata that proved them wrong and smashed an impressive 18 holes into this launch title. Despite the small amount of memory needed to produce this game, well, it became very addicting to play. And the most alluring part was that the golfers resembled both Mario and Luigi from Super Mario Brothers. Okay, maybe they look more like Lou Albano from the Super Mario Super Show, but that aside, seeing Mario appear in 2 launch games back then was really cool because it wasn't really a common thing to happen back then.
Hey, wait a minute! I was in 2 launch titles too!
Oh, shut up, Professor! I can't tell you how many hours I played this game back in the day. This game was a lot of fun, even if that damn wind came along to mess up every one of my damn shots. Talk about an asshole in one. Okay, now it's time for some tennis. Yeah, like we really need another sports game for the system, but what's starting this game? Hey, wait a minute. I know that intro music. That's the same intro music to the game Pro Wrestling, which was also made by Nintendo 2. Those sons of bitches. You mean to tell me they used the intro music to both games? Who approved this decision? Simply incredulous. Well, after hearing that iconic theme song lifted, it's time to get to the game of betting this shit back and forth until, hello, is that Mario yet again? Well, damn, Professor Hector! Looks like another point goes to Mario.
Hey, don't be a sore loser!
So next up is the game of Kung Fu, which I guess is kind of a sports game? Okay, maybe not, but I used to love this game back then, because you'll be fighting through this dojo of death to get your girlfriend back from the bad guy. And if you want to know more, well, check out the awesome review I did of this game a couple years ago. Okay, so finally we have a game that's not a sports game, and that is Clue Clue Land. What the hell's a Clue Clue? Oh, I think it's that little bubbly thingamabob here. Well, eat your heart out, Pac-Man, because this little balloon Clue Clue is after your day job. Because he'll be speeding around the screen, flipping around these Legend of Zelda rupees to try and trap enemies with, or attack enemies with. Oh man, this is getting confusing. Well, while it's not as fun as Pac-Man, it's equally not as memorable either. Because this gameplay is a bit on the confusing side, so I guess gamers kind of toss this one away. Especially when you have this butthole looking thing in the middle of the screen, where enemies keep popping out of. Well, figure out how to beat this level, and the sides of the screen will start to flicker, causing a Pokemon Porygon episode-sized seizure to occur.
Porygon!
Alright, here we have Ice Climber next, and this is probably one of the hardest games in the launch games lineup. And since these characters appear in Super Smash Bros., well, I'm sure this game has seen a whole new generation of fans. But the basic concept here is to scale your way up 32 levels per stage until reaching the top. Along the way, you'll encounter birds, yetis, and bears in Speedos wearing sunglasses. Boy, you could tell this game was made in the 1980s with this kind of shit running around in it. The thing that really sets this game apart is the jumping mechanic. Once progressing upward, well, the bottom ledge will disappear, leaving you wide open to drop down to your death. This feature has polarized NES fans into either hating or loving this mechanic. You dick waffle covered in dripping diarrhea! I hate this game!
Oh, chill out. It's not that bad.
Alright, I guess it isn't that horrible. Bonus levels. My god, this will make you want to blow that hole right out of your ass! Well, let's move on to the game of pinball, which, well, they did try to spruce up this gameplay a bit with adding penguins and little duckies here. Aww. But you'll also get a bonus game here featuring Mario and Pauline from Donkey Kong? Huh, well that's now four games we've got featuring Mario. Up yours, Professor!
No!
So after checking out all 16 of these launch titles, we come to the final one, which is Wrecking Crew. And this game brings our total of Mario games up to 5 because it features our favorite plumber. Now oddly enough, this game was a fun sleeper hit of its time because this puzzle game makes you break doors and explode bombs in the correct order so that you could beat this level. And if you mess that up, you can't beat the level and you are fucked, sir. Oh, and don't think you're getting by without having some weird-ass monsters to chase you down. Because if we check out the instruction book here, well, they're called Eggplant Men and Gotcha Wrenches. Gotcha Wrenches. They couldn't come up with a better name than Gotcha Wrenches? Whatever. Now, even though this is a fun game, it turns out that they actually made 2 sequels to this one, which never made it onto a US gaming console. Oh man, it's like a gotcha wrench right up the ass. Alright, so there you have it. 17 launch games in 1 review. Oh man, we're on the other side of that one. And like I said, Mario had 5 games where Professor Hector had 2, so sorry, Professor, but you're just a washed up has-been. I got the last laugh now.
Sonic the Hedgehog is brilliant, and so is Sonic the Hedgehog, but Sonic the Hedgehog is the absolute worst Sonic game ever made. This ignominy of the universe needs to be buried in the darkest region on Pluto. Now, as retarded as 3 different Sonic games, all with the exact same name is, must this pile of hedgehog shit be one of them? Like, what if a shitty Mario game, I mean, another shitty Mario game is made, and named Super Mario Brothers? It's a shameful disgrace! Anyway, there's too many characters, they're all annoying, worthless, stupid, wimpy, ugly, Play-Doh looking, devoid of any fun, they all suck, and I want to turn them all into Inuit clothing. Now, back in the days, Sonic and Tails were the fucking shit. They were Sega stars, and the only ones that rocked. But too bad they didn't ride the shit train like everyone else. Now Sonic's all stretched out like Gumby, and Tails' tails are too big, and they're barely attached to his body. What happened to these? Now, listen to them.
Okay, with your help, this should be a piece of cake.
I'll do my best.
They're more annoying than Slippy Toad.
Thanks, Fox. I thought they had me.
Their lips synchronized with their original Japanese voice, but should have been edited to match the horribly dubbed English. Sometimes, their lips barely move.
I may not know what Eggman's up to, but it can't be a good thing.
If that's not bad enough, they constantly repeat the dumbest lines.
That tornado's carrying a car! Whoa, that's a big one!
Tails used to be so cool. As cute and adorable that he was badass. And that was his charm. But he's not a super powerful fox anymore. Now, it's logical that he can't fly forever, but couldn't he at least slowly descend to the ground like before? Now he makes a wimpy moaning noise, drops like a pancake into the water without a splash, screams like a little girl, and drowns because, like Sonic, he doesn't know how to swim. He can only attack by throwing dummy ring bombs. It's so stupid. Imagine if Mario could only attack by throwing dummy coin bombs. They're infinitely crammed up his ass, and look, he can't even pick them back up. Couldn't he at least pick them back up, but not have his ring count increase? At least that would make a little more sense. Also, throwing them is awkward because you keep accidentally switching to first person mode. Bottom line, Tails should kick ass by using himself. There should be no dummy ring bombs. Why does Shadow drive vehicles when he should be able to run faster and has chaos powers? It makes as much sense as Kirby sucking up enemies the giant vacuum. Jumping into the vehicles can be a real bitch because sometimes the buttons won't respond. Look, bullets are flying up my ass and he just won't jump in. Skunk fucker, come on, jump in, damn it. Finally! It's like the Warthog, and it looks fun, but trust me, it annoyingly sucks. The controls are stiff and slippery, and you can never slow down fast enough. Damn it! Give me a break! Literally, so I can actually slow down!
You need to get out of here quickly.
This horrible truck needs to get out of here quickly! Are you kidding me?
No!
You didn't need to answer that, Shadow. We all knew the answer. Silver looks like a mutated owl and sounds like Chuck E. Cheese with a clothespin on his nose.
Time for you to disappear, Iblis Trigger!
But if you're not careful, he'll toss you around against the sides of an invisible box. He would be the lamest excuse for an additional hedgehog, but no, this guy takes the bigger portion of the cake. He looks like Shadow, but he's actually another hedgehog. I mean, how many of them do we need? Soon, there'll be enough for supersonic hedgehog brothers. Then there's Knuckles, who started the chain reaction of additional shitty characters, and Rouge the Bat. Once they climb into a wall, they're like permanently stuck.
Get off the wall, you slutty bat bitch!
Oh, and they can magically swim in the air. Look at Knuckles. He makes Goofy look professional. There's also Blaze, Blazing Shit, and others like Amy, who thankfully only make appearances. Now, remember when Sonic didn't suck? Remember the incredible speed, mighty music, checkered ground, springs, rings, loops, waterfalls, totem poles, palm trees, oceans, tubes, lava, ice, and how every single square inch was enriched with majestic dreamlike atmospheres beyond imagination? That was a long time ago. Now, think for a moment. What should Sonic be like? This or this? Do you feel like you're looking at a Sonic game? No, you don't. Absolutely nothing about this catastrophic abomination resembles the classics, and Link would be less out of place in Care-a-Lot. Sonic doesn't belong here, and that's exactly why he isn't here, because this is Sonic, not this. The town is also a horribly bad ripoff of Delfino Plaza. Everything is similar, especially the buildings. Oh, and look, even the portals preview the levels. It's an insult to Mario and Sonic at the exact same time. Even worse, it annoyingly serves as a constant interruption between the levels, which aren't as bad as this, but that's not saying much. That's like saying a pile of moose shit is better than a pile of cow shit. Anyway, couldn't I at least play the damn levels consecutively, the way all levels should be played? The only exception is having to return to the Mushroom Kingdom, because it's magic. But this is a hideous pile of fucking shit! And having to return to it is the biggest waste of time. It's like the bad commercials that interrupt a bad movie. Towns and cities need to dazzle with that Sonic atmosphere. The directions are stupefyingly, moronically idiotic.
Sonic, can you hear me?
Unfortunately,
Knuckles wants to see you.
Send them a photo of my blue ass.
Head to the town's warehouse.
Like, how the fuck am I supposed to know where the town's warehouse is? The town is too big, everything looks exactly the same, and the map is useless because the only thing it pinpoints is your location. So let's face it, you're always gonna be lost, and believe me, I'd rather be lost at the worst place of Antarctica. No, not like this. Never mind. Now, the humans are monstrosities, don't belong in the Sonic universe, and need to be massacred immediately. They're absolutely retarded. And clones are everywhere, silently expressing how shitty this game is. Everyone knows you can't have a Sonic game without an accordion player. Now, the worst of them all is Elise. This half-white, half-orange slut shares a romantic relationship with Sonic. I can't watch this. I'm afraid this nightmare is going to lead to animated hentai bestiality or something. Like the nerd always said, what were they thinking? I hope Amy beats the shit out of this fucking bitch that needs to go back to Final Fantasy where she came from.
If you have time to worry, then run.
The missions aren't retarded, they're vegetables. In this one, all you have to do is keep talking to the first person you see, and that's it. Nothing else.
Incredible.
Yeah, an incredible piece of shit! Now, why is there a store in a Sonic game, and why does it sell only one of one item that only benefits me? It's not like anyone else is gonna buy the light chip. What is Tails doing? Look, even the soccer ball sinks without a splash. What a fucking circus. Loading screens are everywhere, and you can actually beat a few levels from the classics before the end. Look at the random instructions that should only exist in the manual. They're simplified to the point where they don't make any sense. The graphics are realistically ugly when they should be stunningly cartoonish. The level design is bad. Almost nothing is reminiscent of the classics. There's a lot of pop-up. Tree, no tree. Tree, no tree. Invisible walls are everywhere. There's no rumble. Look how bad the camera is. A chimpanzee would handle the camera better. At least the music matches the sceneries. But that's exactly why they're worse than Alvin and the Chipmunks singing with allergies and alarm clocks. The collision detection sucks. You won't find the glitches will find you. Half the game is nothing but button tapping and cinematics glued together. Why would you run through these loops when you don't have to and there's nothing to collect? Sonic doesn't leave footprints in the sand anymore, slides like he's figure skating, and never runs as fast as he used to. He looks like he runs even slower because of the overly stretched dimensions of the levels. Instead of the robots resembling animals like they should, they resemble unwanted crap deleted from Metroid Prime. Some of the rings are impossible to get. They wouldn't be so difficult if the camera didn't change angles, or if the controls weren't so bad. Yes! No! Fuck Nozzle! Now look at this! Sonic outruns this orca, jumps on flying pieces of wood, jumps on the orca's fin, and now logically, you'd assume that Jackie Chan's gonna jump to that nearby island, but no. Instead, he clings onto the fin like a frightened cat, and now Tails has to save him. It's the lamest excuse to force him to play as Tails, who should have been following my ass to begin with. And what was he doing, randomly standing by the edge of the dock? To save Sonic, you hit the switch. But why would you want to spoil the fun? Okay, why is there even a gate here? Am I in a fucking aquarium? And why was it left open to begin with? Now look at that! It doesn't even fully close! Why doesn't this stupid orca just swim underneath? Or go around? Look at it! How the fuck could it block the way?
Nothing makes any logical sense. How did Sonic know the orca was trying to escape? Why did the orca try to escape the second Sonic jumped on its fin? Why weren't the other orcas trying to escape? And why didn't Sonic try to set them free instead of keeping them imprisoned? I mean, what an asshole!
Thank you, Tails, you saved me!
No, he didn't! You saved yourself by jumping away and defeated the entire purpose of having to play as Tails. Now, could the infinite train, loaded with bullshit, be any longer? Yes. How the hell did he jump from here all the way to here? Now there's no reason why he couldn't jump to that nearby island at the very beginning. If you don't hit the switch, you have to watch this. That was almost 10 seconds of nothing. Why doesn't Sonic jump away like he did before a partially closed gate? The orca disappears into the gate and beneath the water. Now the camera shakes, and this is a cutscene.
Darn! We're not gonna make it! Let's speed up!
Oh, now he runs faster? If he ran faster at the very beginning, he would have caught up by now. One up? What's wrong with this? And I die 2 seconds later? Why are they replaced by empty containers? What a crap full of fuck platypus. Okay, so I beat the level, but why does Sonic stop and pose in the middle of the chase? Remember the feather scene from Forrest Gump? Hard not to, isn't it? Riding the snowboard looks fun, but trust me, it sucks more than a vacuum. The controls are horrible. Fuck! It's like riding a unicycle, wearing a sumo suit, moving a horse on a baby stroller through a bunch of winding hills. No, don't go up! Oh, come on! It didn't even hit me! Well, now I'm fucked. What? You could go right through it? What? I died? Now, before, the lamest excuse forced you to play as Tails, but now, for absolutely no reason at all, you're simply just forced to play as him. And that's actually worse because, well, they didn't even try! Fuck! Also, if Tails was already about halfway through the level, then why didn't he just finish it by himself without waiting for Sonic? Are they trying to save the world, or are they baton racing with invisible batons? Well, I couldn't tell you exactly what they're doing. Why? Because the story is a completely illogical fucking encyclopedia.
If we don't return in time, Elise will die on board Eggman's battleship. That means...
That means you travel back even further in time. I mean, if you can travel through time, then why should you worry about it? I mean, why should you run about it? Oh, you're gonna love this one. Shadow jumps into this portal. Oh, you son of a bitch. And out comes Rouge the Bat. We? What do you mean, we? Shadow jumped into the portal. I don't know where the fuck you came from. Now, this is where the game really takes it up the ass. Dying is easier than the kindergarten math test. Believe me, you don't want to fuck around in this death playground. Everything wants you dead. The almost unavoidable obstacles on the road and falling debris that comes out of nowhere and hits you in a fraction of a second, the camera by changing angles, the bad frame rate by making you run faster than the camera and crash into objects, and ironically, even the rings, because when you magically glide through them, the straightforward momentum hurls you into even more objects. Also, if you stay too close to the edges, you die. If you jump too early, you die. If you jump too late, you die. And because you can only jump straight, if you jump at the wrong angle, you die. You will die again and again and again and again and again. I can't take it anymore.
This game is a disgrace to the Hedgehog's legacy. Why is it so bad? Why is it so fucking atrocious? I'd have more fun being trapped underneath two triceratops, fucking, while one of them takes a diarrhea on my face. It's vomited hedgehog poison shit, diluted mushy green, partially undigested rotting cow shit. It sucks. It really sucks. It super fucking sucks, so much super fucking gorilla fuck, it fucking sucks itself inside out, infinitely beyond imagination, and makes black holes explode. And I think it's a pile of poop